request Advocate Mihir Desai to speak next. Advocate Mihir doesn't need an introduction. He has been a human rights lawyer who has fought for the release of many, many prisoners, and most recently the Bhima Koregaon people arrested in the Bhima Koregaon conspiracy case. He got bail orders for the release of Tista Settlewar, Dr. Anand Tumre. After getting order for release of Mahesh Rao in September last year, the Supreme Court has stayed it for over 1 year. He is also the president of PUCL Maharashtra and a leading voice not just as a lawyer but as a vocal spokesperson for the marginalized. He has been a fearless and vocal critic of government policies, whether of BJP or previous Congress regime. And he has also stood by young people who, whenever they have been arrested in protest cases. That was
my... I was involved in Sai's case only peripherally, in the sense that I had gone to argue his medical bail in the before the Nagpur bench. The reason why I'm saying this is because at that time, that was in 2018, that was just after Surendra, who was his lawyer, had been arrested. June 2018. Because I was arguing the medical bail, I had to go through the medical papers of Sai. And it was even in 2018 that the doctors had very categorically said that he needed a gallbladder surgery, which finally happened in 2024 and which finally led to his death. So this is not something which happened suddenly in 2024. This was happening right from the beginning. But I won't speak much about his what happened to him medically, and I think I will cover that. But I just want to add two things, that there are two people who we must also congratulate today. One is a person who is a lawyer who did a stellar job in arguing the case. One of the leading lawyers who did a stellar job in arguing his case before the Nagpur bench. And that is Mr. Pradeep Mandyan, who is with us today, and he's the... And the second person who actually created the foundation for what was argued in the High Court through his cross-examination, through his perseverance, through following up every procedural aspect and substantive aspect, who is unfortunately not with us today. Here, he is with us. That is Mr. Surendra Gandhi, who was his lawyer in the session. And of course, Gayatri, who got him the medical bail in Bombay High Court. So, I think it's very important to note their contributions. Why was he in jail? And why was he released? These are the two questions, because I think what Sai was, what he did, is all what Sushmita as well as Bernard mentioned. I'll just focus a little bit on the case and why was he in jail. Of course, I mean, politically he was in jail for X, Y and Z reasons which we all know about. But in terms of legality, why was he in jail? See, according to the version of the prosecution, the police, on 1st September 23, there are three people who are arrested from a bus stop. These are Mr. Prashant Rahi, Vijay Tirki, Mahesh Tirki, Pandu Narote, and Hem Mishra. These are the three people who are arrested allegedly from a bus stop because they were having some suspicion discussion with each other. So these three people are arrested on the basis of what they say to the police. Two others, namely Prashant Rahi and Vijay Tirki, are arrested on 1st September 23. And police then discover that actually Mahesh, Hem Mishra had come to Gadchiroli to give a pen drive which had been given to him by Sai in Delhi to give it to somebody in the forest. I mean, this is the story. Okay, this is the story as to why he was, and therefore then they raided him, raided Sai's place on 7th September 23, and finally after nearly 8 months on 9th May 14, he was arrested. 9th May 14, he was arrested, and in March 24, of course, he was released, acquitted. So this was the thing. And what was the ground of arrest? That things were found from his computer, things were found from his house, from the other people, certain pamphlets were found, which basically showed that they were part of the Dexalite. They were active parts in involved in terrorist activities. This is basically the story which was given. I mean, the question is whether they should have got bail immediately. I think that's a wrong question. Question should be whether they should have been arrested in the first place at all or not. And I would say that they should not have been inside jail even for an hour. Bail comes later if you are arrested. They should not have been arrested at all. None of these five. On the basis of the evidence which is there, they should not have been arrested. Anyway, they were arrested. Bail rejected. Trial goes on. After the during the trial, medical bail is rejected by the Nagpur High Court. Then the Bombay High Court grants medical bail for 3 months. In the meanwhile, the judge in Nagpur gets wild at Bombay High Court having given this kind of a bail. The Nagpur bench not only cancels the bail but passes a separate 60-page order saying how the Chief Justice cannot take away case from me and pass this order. I mean, politics doesn't happen it happens inside the courtrooms quite a bit. I'm just mentioning that. Anyway, after that, so his bail is cancelled. After the 3 months, he's taken back. In the meanwhile, he's convicted by the Sessions Court. After the Sessions Court is convicted, the matter goes to High Court. High Court, the conviction order is, in my view, an absolute absurdity. The order which convicted him is a complete absurdity. But anyway, he is convicted. Matter goes to High Court. Medical bail is not granted, but the matter is taken up after a few months, few years. And the division bench of the High Court gives a judgment which acquits all of them on the basis that certain procedural mandatory requirements of the law had not been followed. Therefore, all five are let off, saying that the entire institution of the case itself was wrong. So they are let off. Fine. On the next day, the matter goes to Supreme Court. We all know about the wonderful Saturday hearing which happened in the Supreme Court. Unheard of, because in Saturdays, yes, sometimes they sit, but they sit on Saturdays to give people liberty, not to take away their liberty. This is the first time Supreme Court had a sitting on a Saturday to take away the liberty of a person, and a stay is granted by the Supreme Court. After that stay, after about 10 months, the matter is sent back to the High Court to hear, to give it a hearing. In the meanwhile, the judge who had acquitted this person is summarily transferred to another High Court. He knows why he is transferred. We all know why he is transferred. And he resigns on the same day, the Bombay High Court judge, and says, I don't want to continue as a judge here. And he resigns. This is what happens. Anyway, despite that, and that's something which we must appreciate, the two judges of the Bombay High Court who then heard the matter acquit all five of them, not just six, because one of them in the meanwhile unfortunately had passed away, that is Pandu Narohe. He passed away at the age of about 36 in jail because he got swine flu for which there was no treatment available. I'm sure Gayatri will talk about the medical situation in jails, but so that was the thing. So all are acquitted. Now remember one thing, that all these, there are 11 reasons why all these people are acquitted. It's not a technicality. Okay? There are 11 reasons why these people are acquitted. Okay? Do I have 3-4 minutes more? Okay. I'll quickly tell you what those reasons are in 30 seconds each. That will give me 3 minutes, right? Okay. Fine. First of all, the court says that since you are being prosecuted under UAPA, the draconian law, there is a requirement that a sanction has to be given by an authority, by the secretary, etc., after a report is submitted by an independent authority to the secretary. That means, but by giving the report, whether UAPA should be invoked or not, there has to be an application of mine. You have to go through the evidence to find out whether UAPA is made out or not. The court comes to the conclusion that there is no application of mine by the authority who made the report, there is no application of mine by the authority who granted sanctions. So at both levels, okay, there is complete non-application of mine. If you do that, if there is non-application of mine, the entire case collapses. So the case collapses, the matter ends. That's point number one. Point number two, they say that, and I just go to 5 or 6 points, I won't get into all 11. But the point number two, they say that the search and seizure, because everything, the court says that the entire case depends on certain documents and certain electronic evidence. That's what it depends on. It doesn't depend on anything else. There is no act of violence. There is no recovery of arms. There is no recovery of money. Nothing like that. So it's everything depends on certain documents, pamphlets and electronic material recovered. They say that the search carried out in respect of all three batches, that is the first batch where three of them were arrested from the bus stop, second batch when Prashant and Vijay Tirki are arrested, and the third where Sai Baba's house is raided. All three are in complete violation of all mandatory provisions of the Criminal Procedure Code. All. That's the second thing they say. They in fact suggest very categorically that actually these people were arrested much before they were arrested. So they were detained earlier and they were shown to be arrested later. And things seem to have been planted. This is the kind of conclusion which is suggested. Things seem to have been planted. One thing. Second thing, a very important aspect. As far as Sai Baba is concerned, the electronic evidence they say, that there is a method of collecting electronic evidence so that it's secure electronic evidence, so that its integrity is maintained. One is you take hash value, second is you provide the details of what the electronic evidence, what is the hard disk you are taking, what is its number, etc., etc. Nothing. It's not available. This is important not only for this case, but generally. The hash value is a central thing for, if you are taking up electronic evidence. Second thing, so Sai is concerned. Sai and the punch were kept outside the house when the search was going on inside. So you don't know what is planted, what is not planted. So the court comes to the conclusion, this is absolutely bogus, you can't do it. Third, the police said that, look, videography was done of the search. But the video was never produced. It was never produced in court. If you have done videography, you yourself claim that you have done videography of a search to show that the search was done properly, fairly, etc. Where is that video? Nobody produced that video. So this is about search, seizure, etc. So they said that none of the documents on which you are saying that these people having, we have found this material can at all be relied upon. Because the integrity is completely lost. That's what they say. The next thing they say is that there are confessions.
two of the first persons who were arrested, Mahesh and Pandu, had allegedly given confession, saying that, I saw, whatever. The court comes to the conclusion that these confessions cannot be relied upon. The court, in fact, seems to suggest that these were extracted through coercion. These confessions were extracted through coercion. So this is the next point. So they say confession has to be ignored. It's not to be relied upon. The next thing which the court says is that forget the procedural part, and there are many more procedure parts which they go into, how at every stage the procedure was violated. Every stage the procedure was violated. But the next thing they say is that, okay, this is procedure, but let me assume that whatever they have collected, whatever the police said they have collected from the electronic evidence, the pamphlets, etc., let me assume they are correct, that they are actually collected, that they are actually belong to these people. Even if I assume that, that's what the judges say, that even if we assume that everything is right, what they are saying, even then this does not amount to any kind of a UAPA offense. But the court says that having pamphlets is not an offense. Having some letters, even supporting, what the court makes a very important distinction, that because we have freedom of conscience, even if I support a violent method of overthrowing the state, that will not amount to an offense unless I actually act on it. Unless I actually provide guns, go there, plant bombs, call for bombs, give money, etc. The court says very clear that, look, what I believe in my mind or what I need is not what is will not determine whether I have committed. For in order to commit an offence, I have to act it out. I can't think it out. It has to be acted out. That's what the court says as far as the substance is concerned. That pamphlets, anybody can have pamphlets of all kinds. And that Supreme Court has also said in one or two other judgments that pamphlets, anybody can have all kinds of pamphlets, doesn't mean that you are guilty of some terrorist act or something. People read, I have Mein Kampf in my house. I want to know what Hitler said. Does it make me a Nazi or something? It doesn't. So, what was also important about the judgment is it said that even substantively, not just procedurally, but substantively, there is a violation. There is no violation of the law, and therefore we are acquitting. So on substance as well as on procedure, they acquitted. The unfortunate part is that despite, you know, on borderline essentially saying that these people have been framed, there is no action suggested against any of the officers. No compensation is ordered to these people for having spent 10 years in jail. Nothing. And that's where the problem lies, according to me. One of the problems. Because what happens is, for the same policeman, next time they will arrest another batch of 10 people. It doesn't matter, because they will arrest next batch of 10 people. Ultimately, at the end of 10 years, they might be, acquitted. But there is no harm coming to me as an officer. There is no accountability as far as I am concerned. So how does it matter? So I feel the courts have to go 2-3 steps forward when you come to this kind of a case, because these people have lost their lives. I mean, not just Sai, but even the others. 10 years gone down the drain. I mean, they might be optimistic people, they are all optimistic people, etc., all that is there. But the fact of the matter is that these people have lost their lives, and there has to be something done. Something which has to be done. And of course, as I said earlier, I personally believe that if Sai had been given proper treatment, if Sai had not been in jail, or even if he was in jail, if he had been given proper treatment, because he only went inside with the polio and came out with 10 other diseases, even a fully healthy person, without any disability, goes inside jail and stays for 10 years, you will come out with a lot of problems. So I personally believe that he would have been alive, but for the fact that he was in jail, and therefore I have no problems in calling it an institutional murder. It doesn't have to be a case like Stan, where a person is inside and then he dies. Even after you come out, if you die because of the after effects of what has happened to you, it is still an institutional murder. That's all. Thank you very much.
Advocate Gayatri has been a leading lawyer for the working class rights, for unions, environment, urban planning issues and women. She has campaigned for the housing rights of retrenched textile mill workers. She took up the case of Kanchan Nanavare, who died as an under trial prisoner due to medical negligence and botched up medical procedure. She is now arguing the case in High Court for bringing accountability to prison and hospital authorities in dealing with the health issues of terminally ill prisoners. So it will be great if Advocate Gayatri can shed light on the condition. All of us have been really disturbed by the conditions in the jail, which are causing all of these health issues, and then lack of any emergency sort of medical care that a lot of accused in the Bhima Koregaon case also have faced, and there's no immediate response, or the response comes very late. So, added to that is the lens of disability. So, Advocate Gayatri.
So I just like to start by saying that the death of Sai Baba is a classic case of institutional murder. And the reason why I say this is because when he came out of, when he was released in March 2024, at that point of time, he was already suffering from various ailments, which got exacerbated because of his long and torturous incarceration under inhuman conditions. The issue with regard to his treatment is something that I can go on and on and on, but I don't want to take too much of time on that. But we should recognize the fact that it is a case of institutional murder, because a person with disabilities who is imprisoned, when the state is fully aware of the fact that he is suffering from various ailments which were not of a serious nature, which were being monitored when he was out in Delhi under the AIMMS care. He was being monitored, he was doing physiotherapy, he was getting the proper medication, and he was fine. But as soon as he was arrested, and here in this case it is not just an arrest, he was actually abducted. It is not even like he went under the normal procedure of arrest. He was abducted by so-called unknown people, and it was Vasanta, his wife, who had to make a complaint of missing person. And on that basis, the police had then to come forward and say, no, it's not unknown person, but it is an arrest which took place by the police. So here we have a case of a person who is abducted, falsely arrested, false charges are put on him, and then he is dumped into this prison where there are absolutely no medical facilities available. As a person with 90% disability, you have to take care of the person who is being imprisoned, whether he is an under trial or whether he is a convicted prisoner. We, India, is a signatory of international covenants on disability, which says very specifically that people with disability should be prohibited from staying inside the prison for long periods of time. So you violate that, fine. Then you get this person inside. You know that he is wheelchair ridden. you take away the wheelchair and then he is made to crawl on all fours just to go to the toilet, just to get some water. He is in solitary confinement. There's nobody there to help him. And there are no attendants. You're supposed to have attendants to help a person with disability. So he has to crawl in this most humiliating fashion to get it to the toilet. Then you take away his medication, which was absolutely essential. You do not provide him with the dietary benefit, the food which is required when you are given strong medicines. So you take away that. Then everybody knows that he was suffering from a spinal problem, which actually affected the muscles as well as the lungs and as well as the heart. He had problems with the heart. All these issues were well known to the prison authorities. So is it not murder? Is it not murder when you don't even attempt to look after a prison with basic medical benefits? So here is this person who has absolutely no medical help, no medical treatment, no medical care, no physiotherapy, which was the basic essential requirement for a person suffering from those ailments. So as soon as he's arrested and inside, he makes an application for bail on medical grounds as well as on merits. The most surprising part is that you make an application, you write down all your problems, everything is on record. The magistrate does not even look at the reasons that he has given. The chief medical officer, who's supposed to submit a report, when you're considering the bail application for medical reasons, you're supposed to give details of what his medical condition is. The magistrate, the sessions judge, asks for details from the medical officer. Medical officer gives those details, long drawn out details. But the fortunate part is that he cannot hide from the fact that yes, he was suffering from ABC diseases. So he writes down those ailments, which is heart problem, gallbladder problem, pancreatic problem, muscle cramps, spinal problem, pushing against your lungs, the lungs are being affected. All this is written in that report. Despite that, the judge just looks at the report and says, oh, everything is fine. He is going to be treated properly by the prison authorities. There's absolutely no problem. All the required medical care is being given. Now, we have a manual. We have a prison manual. We have various other laws which say that when you are making this application, medical application, the medical officer makes this report, he is supposed to not only say what are the ailments, but what sort of treatment is being given to him has to be recorded. So what was the treatment that was being given? What was the medication that was being provided? Is the medication or the treatment that is being given by the jail authorities sufficient? Does it have all the facilities available? If it does not, then will he be treated elsewhere and given the required medical treatment? All these facts need to be recorded. Even if it is not recorded, is it not the responsibility of the judge to ask the prison authorities that what is the treatment that you are giving him? Is it sufficient? No such inquiry is made, and he writes an order which basically says that he is fine, there's no problem, and he is being properly treated, and that's how his medical bail gets rejected and the bail on merits. Once it gets rejected, during this period of time, which is even more astonishing and it should make us angry, is the fact that even before he made the medical bail application, he was being ill-treated, as I said. He was not provided with medical medication, etc., etc. But as soon as he made the application, suddenly everything came to him. He got his wheelchair, he got his medication, he got all the special treatment that was required to be given while he was inside. And the judge says he is getting everything. Naturally, he's getting everything because he just started giving it. And as soon as the matter is over and rejected, it goes back to that same situation where he was deprived of his wheelchair, his attendance, his medical care, medication. I mean, this is a serious situation. So the situation becomes even worse, the situation gets even worse, and then finally, ultimately, Arundhati Roy writes an article in Outlook. I don't know if everyone has read that, during that period in 2015. And she brings out all this, what is happening inside the prison. She states in detail what his condition inside is, that it is going to get worse unless something is done urgently. She also says that this is discrimination, double standards, because here is a person who is admittedly suffering from all these ailments. You refuse to consider all this, but just during that period of time, Babu Bajrangi, I think everybody has heard of him, who played a role in murdering 97 people in Gujarat, and he's convicted with life imprisonment, and he makes an application to court saying, I'm suffering from urgent eye problems, I need bail, I need to be released from bail. The court considers it and says, yes, very serious, and immediately releases him on bail. And the second, there are so many instances which she narrates, Arundhati. The second incident is of Maya Kodani, who also was sentenced to 28 years of imprisonment. And she comes and says, I have intestinal problems, I have gastric problems, I have TB, etc. And therefore, I need to be released. And the court suspends her sentence and releases her. So here we have instances galore of rich, mighty people, political people who are released, whereas here a person who is defending the rights of the poor, who has not committed any crime, has not murdered anyone, is thrown inside and almost murdered. So finally, I just want to say that as far as Arundhati Roy's article is concerned, it was on the basis of our article that Purnima wrote a letter to the Bombay High Court saying that please consider this, his health problem, on an urgent basis. And the High Court, for whatever reason, we won't go into the details of it, but he passed an order saying that yes, we will consider the medical issues, and therefore he called for a report, the Chief Justice called for a report of his medical condition. Then that report came in, we pointed out, and Susan was there, Vijay Hiramath was there, we had to do a lot of jugglery on medical terms, remember? And at that time, we pointed out that he needs to go to a private hospital where he will be independently examined and not by the prison officials. And that was what the order was, where the court directed that he should be allowed to go to a private hospital of his choice and be treated there. I just have 5 more minutes. And so he was sent there. Even there, the prison authorities tried to interfere with the medical examination. They did not allow Vasanta, his wife, to be present, even though the court said she should remain present. They did not allow his brother to be present. And they did not allow the independent doctor, who was a friend of Sai, Dr. Ramteke, to be present. It was only after we went back to court that the court said, no, you should allow them to be present, and that's how the examination took place. When the examination report came, it is shocking. When the report came out, the report used a word which I keep forgetting. It is a disease called the interior horn cell disease. Does anyone know what that is? We did all kinds of research on that and found out that it is a disease of the muscular system which affects it so badly, if you are not able to control it in time, that it can lead to death. And this is for the first time it is reported in the report that is submitted by this doctor who is supposed to be independent. So we researched the disease and we found out that the effect of this is it leads to death, it leads to spinal degeneration, it leads to muscular degeneration, and it will ultimately lead to a situation where he will no longer be able to carry out his normal activities or move about. So on the basis of this report, it is on this basis that the High Court released him on medical bail, saying that he should, it was 3 months and then later extended to 3 months till December 2015. I remember, and I just want to end here, I remember after he was released, I went and met him, and I will never forget that meeting because he was the most joyous person, most as if nothing had happened to him, and we were trying to figure out what sort of treatment could be given immediately. The doctors that we met were so friendly and so helpful that we really felt that, okay, now he is in good hands. And we left, and unfortunately, this judge, Chaudhary, took up the matter. I don't want to go into details, but took it up because it was, according to him, in his jurisdiction, Nagpur bench. And if you read the judgment, if you read the order, it has nothing to do with medical bail. It has nothing to do with the merits of the case. It's just one paragraph on merit saying that he is a terrorist. He is arrested under the UAPA. He has committed so-and-so offense under so-and-so section. That's it. Why? What did you find? What is the prima facie case that has made out? Nothing. And unfortunately, just when he was supposed to undergo the pancreatic surgery, he was thrown again inside the jail. And his situation after that happened in 2015, when the gallbladder situation was already existed at Mihir Desai in 2015. And now, after his release, when he goes, naturally there are all kinds of problems, and he dies according to them, complications. It's nothing to do with complications. You have created a situation where he is bound to die because of the lack of medical treatment given to him. Thank you.